Hey everyone, my name's Dr. Robin, aka Double O Pi, and in this video, I'm going to teach you how to convert between concentration units. The specific concentration units we'll refer to in this video are molarity, molality, mass percent, and mole fraction. Now, if you don't remember what those units represent, go back and look at my concentration unit video linked in the description below. Because there are so many different conversions that you might have to do, in this video, we're going to lay out a very generic problem-solving approach that you can use for any concentration conversion, even concentration units that aren't listed in this video. The first step is to identify which concentration unit you're trying to find. Now, in this video, I'm going to be pretty explicit as to what you're solving for, but sometimes you'll have a problem that requires you to use a particular concentration unit in order to get the right answer. For example, using molality for freezing point depression. And sometimes that's not going to be stated outright. The second step is to remember the definition of that unit and use it to determine what quantities you need to know in order to be able to calculate that concentration. For example, if you're looking for mass percent of some chemical in a solution, you need to know the mass of that chemical as well as the total mass of the solution. The third step here is the most vague, and this is the one that's really going to vary from problem to problem. Essentially, what you're going to do here is make a plan for figuring out how to find the quantities you defined in step two, using the information that you have. And we're going to talk a bit more about that soon. Finally, once you have the quantities you were solving for, you can go ahead and plug those into the definition for the concentration unit you were looking for to get your final answer. Okay, so back to the third step. How do you know how to get from what you know to what you need to know? First of all, you're usually going to have to assume a certain amount of something, and I like to assume 100. 100 what? Well, that depends on what you know. For example, if you know mass percent, it might be useful to assume 100 grams. If you know the molarity of a solution, you might want to assume that you have 100 milliliters. Basically, you're going to pick 100 convenient units. And you'll see examples of this as I work the sample problems. Once you have that assumption, you can think about what sorts of things you need to know. There are only a limited number of things you will need to know about a solution, and I've made a diagram here that explains the relationships between them. First, we can think about what we know about each component of the solution. How much mass and how many moles of the solute? And how much mass and how many moles of the solvent? Then we can look at the solution as a whole. What's the volume of the solution? What's the total mass? What's the total number of moles? All of these quantities are related to each other in some fashion or another. For example, I have all of the masses listed in blue because if you know two of the three masses, you can find the third. The same is true of the number of moles, which I've highlighted in red. Now, another obvious relationship is between the mass and numbers of moles of your solute or solvent. We can convert between these with the molar mass of each substance. Finally, we can convert between the mass of the solution and the volume using the density. So to make your plan, figure out what you know and what you want to know. Then use these relationships to create a series of steps that will help you convert from one to the other. As usual, these steps will make a lot more sense if we apply them to a real problem, so let's go ahead and do that. In this problem, we're dealing with a 50% weight per weight solution of sodium hydroxide. Step one is, of course, to identify the concentration unit that you want to solve for. Here, that's molarity. In step two, you're going to use the definition of molarity to figure out what quantities you need to solve for. Now, when I ask students how molarity is defined, they often say moles per liter. And while that's correct, it's really important to think about moles of what? And liters of what? A more specific definition is moles of solute, which in this case is sodium hydroxide, per liter of solution. Now you're at step three. And remember, this was the vague one where you have to create a plan to get what you want to know. Moles of sodium hydroxide and liters of solution from what you do know, which in this case is mass percent and density. So as usual, the best way to start is to assume 100, and when you're dealing with mass percent, it's ideal to assume that you have 100 grams. Why is that ideal? because mass percent tells you what part of that 100 grams will be sodium hydroxide. If you have a mass of sodium hydroxide, you can find the number of moles pretty easily using the molar mass, which will give you moles of solute. Now you just need to find how many liters of total solution you have. How can you do that if you only know the mass? Well, by using the density as a conversion factor. That will give you the volume in milliliters, but you can easily convert that to liters. Now go ahead and do the calculations. Step A was to calculate the mass of sodium hydroxide based on the mass of solution and the mass percent. Here you see why it's nice to assume 100 rather than some other mass of solution. I wrote out the math longhand, but you can really just do it in your head, because 50% of 100 is just 50. In step B, you take those 50 grams of sodium hydroxide and use the molar mass of sodium hydroxide to convert to moles. That tells you that you have 1.25 moles of sodium hydroxide. And then in step C, you're going to take your total mass of solution, again, 100 grams, and use the density as a conversion factor. Each milliliter of solution weighs 1.529 grams, and if you throw in the conversion from mils to liters, you see that 100 grams of solution is equal to 0.0654 liters of solution. Okay, so now that you've finished your calculation plan and know how many moles of solute you have and how many liters of solution you have, you can go ahead and plug those quantities into your original definition of molarity. Run that through your calculator and you find that you have a 19.1 molar solution of sodium hydroxide. Let's try another problem. This problem gives the mole fraction and density of a potassium iodide solution and asks you to find two different things, the molality and mass percent of Ki. Now, it may seem like this sort of problem will take two times as long as the last one, but it really won't, because you'll end up using some of the quantities for the first half in the second half. So once again, you're going to follow the same steps as before. First, identify the unit, or in this case, units, you want to calculate. The problem spells these out fairly distinctly as molality and mass percent. What are the definitions of these various units? Well, molality is moles of solute per kilogram of solvent, while mass percent is mass of a particular chemical divided by total mass of the solution times 100%. So you need to know your moles of solute, which here is moles of potassium iodide, and the mass of potassium iodide. What about the total mass? Well, the total mass is just the mass of potassium iodide plus the mass of water, and I've already talked about both of those. Where do you start? Well, you're given the mole fraction of potassium iodide, so it makes sense to start by assuming that you have 100 moles. You can then use the mole fraction of Ki to figure out how many moles of Ki there are. If you have the number of moles of Ki, you can figure out how many moles of water there are. It's whatever's left of the 100 moles you started with. Once you have numbers of moles for both solution components, you can use the molar masses to determine what masses you have, both for water and for Ki, and then you can get the total mass. So now it's time to put the plan into action. For part A, take the 100 total moles you assumed and multiply by the mole fraction of 0.0444. This gives you 4.44 moles of Ki. This also means that there are 100 minus 4.44, or 95.56, moles of water. The mass of water will be 95.56 moles of water times the molar mass of 18.015 grams per mole, 1,721.5 grams, or 1.7215 kilograms. 4.44 moles of potassium iodide times the molar mass of 166.03 grams per mole gives 737.1 grams of potassium iodide. Finally, to get the total mass, add 737.1 grams of Ki to 1,721.5 grams of water to get 2,458.6 grams. So at this point, you have enough information to calculate both units of concentration. Molality is moles of solute divided by kilograms of solvent. Here that's 4.44 moles of potassium iodide divided by 1.7215 kilograms of solvent. That gives a concentration of 2.58 molel. The mass percent of Ki is 737.1 grams divided by the total mass of 2,458.6 grams. Multiplying that decimal by 100% tells us that the mass percent of Ki in the solution is 30.0%. Let's look at one last problem. Here you're given the molarity and density of an aqueous solution of sulfuric acid. Again, for step one, you've been told explicitly that you need to calculate both the mole fraction and the molality of sulfuric acid in the solution. The mole fraction is going to be the number of moles of sulfuric acid divided by the total number of moles in solution. The molality will be the moles of sulfuric acid divided by the mass of solvent in kilograms. Time to develop a plan. When you're starting with molarity, it's often a good idea to assume that you have 100 milliliters of solution. When you know molarity and volume, you can calculate the number of moles of sulfuric acid. You also need to know the mass of water. So how can you find this? Well, first, calculate the total mass of the solution using the density and volume. Then use the number of moles of sulfuric acid and the molar mass to figure out the mass of sulfuric acid in the solution. Finally, subtract the mass of sulfuric acid from the total mass to get the mass of water. The last step is to use the mass of water to calculate how many moles of water you have. Then you can add this to the number of moles of sulfuric acid to get the total number of moles in the solution. All right, time to put the plan into action. In the first step, we multiply the molarity times the number of liters of solution. 100 milliliters is 0.100 liters, which gives 1.35 moles of sulfuric acid. Next, multiply the density by the volume of the solution to get the total mass of solution, 170 grams. Multiply the number of moles of sulfuric acid by the molar mass, 98.079 grams, to get the mass of sulfuric acid in solution, 132.4 grams. Subtract that mass from the total mass of the solution, and you find that there are 37.6 grams of water in the solution. Using the molar mass of water, you could see that this is equal to 2.09 moles of water. Adding the number of moles for sulfuric acid and water, you find that there are 3.44 total moles in the solution. So now you have all the information you need to calculate the concentrations. The mole fraction of sulfuric acid is calculated by dividing 1.35 moles of sulfuric acid by the total number of moles, 3.44, which gives you a mole fraction of 0.392. The molality can be found by dividing the number of moles of sulfuric acid by the mass of the solvent in kilograms. Earlier, you calculated that there were 37.6 grams of water, so make sure that gets converted to 0.0376 kilograms before dividing. This gives a concentration of 35.9 molal. So as you can see, strategy is definitely necessary for figuring out how to convert between concentration units. You need to identify what quantities you already know, what quantities you need to know, and use known relationships to convert between them. Of course, you can also use the strategies I laid out in this video for other concentration units as well. Things like parts per million, parts per billion, and weight per volume, for example. Just like the units we covered in this video, these are all linked to the basic information that you work with in step three of the problem-solving process. I hope this was helpful. Thanks for watching, and I look forward to seeing you again soon.